In 1913, a French naturalist described a poorly preserved upper jaw from the late Jurassic period. The teeth in that jaw were large and serrated, like steak knives, the kind of teeth that could only have come from a predator. And for decades, paleontologists thought that this fossil belonged to a carnivorous dinosaur called Megalosaurus, which kind of made sense at the time. In the early years of paleontology, researchers didn't know how diverse ancient animals were, so a lot of fossils were just grouped under the same few names. But then, in 1982, the real owner of that jaw was identified. Turns out experts had actually been dealing with a completely different kind of apex predator, one that was as deadly in the water as Megalosaurus was on land. That jaw belonged to a fully marine croc relative that was adapted for life in saltwater, known as Agiosaurus. Now, yes, there are crocs today that do just fine in saltwater, like the very appropriately named saltwater crocodile, but they still hang out in freshwater and on land too. But Agiosaurus and its kin completely gave that up. They lived out at sea, full-time, their whole lives. And in fact, the group that Agiosaurus belonged to, like many ancient marine reptiles, actually made this transition twice. But let me tell you, taking that plunge was not easy, because it turns out it takes a very special set of traits to fully dedicate yourself to life at sea. Now, Agiosaurus was just one member of a larger family of aquatic reptiles called metriorhynchids that lived from the Middle Jurassic to the Early Cretaceous period. While dinosaurs were dominating the land, the metriorhynchids were thriving in the seas. And they might look pretty familiar, even if you've never heard of them before. They probably remind you of animals like mosasaurs, ichthyosaurs, and plesiosaurs. And while these four groups are all marine reptiles, they actually don't share an ancient marine reptile common ancestor. Instead, these groups all evolved independently of one another to live in the water. Mosasaurs, for example, descended from terrestrial lizards, similar to modern-day monitor lizards, while the ancestors of the metriorhynchids were croc relatives that lived on land. That makes all of these groups secondarily aquatic. That means that in each case, their terrestrial ancestors originally evolved from aquatic animals millions of years earlier, making this their second time around as marine animals. Which is weird, right? Sounds exhausting. So if these animals each evolved separately, why did they all look so similar? Well, if you're an Eon superfan, and you probably are, you might already know the answer. It's another case of convergent evolution. The same process that gave us carnivorous plants and way too many things that look like crabs but actually aren't crabs. As aquatic predators, the different groups of marine reptiles all independently developed similar adaptations to go with their similar lifestyle. Now, for a while, even though we knew that metriorhynchids were secondarily aquatic, we weren't really sure how this transition back to the water happened. But in 2018, a group of paleontologists described a remarkable transitional fossil. It was an animal that they named Bariorosuchus. This 180-million-year-old animal had a unique blend of terrestrial and marine traits, placing it midway between older land-based croc relatives and their seafaring descendants. And this blend of traits highlights some of the many obstacles that needed to be overcome to transition from life on land to life in the water. Like, how do you even move in the water? Meet Docosaurus, a close relative of Agiosaurus, and one from whom we have more complete fossils. This croc relative had a sleek, streamlined body that helped reduce drag in the water, making it much more hydrodynamic. It also had a tail fluke to propel itself, as well as paddle-shaped limbs for steering and a little extra power. And even early transitional croc relatives, like that Mosasaurus, had a tail fin. And unlike their terrestrial relatives, true metriorhynchids had no osteoderms, which are bony structures in the skin that help provide protection and can help regulate body temperature. This helped give them maximum flexibility for maneuvering in the water. But Mosasaurus still had osteoderms, so it looks like the tail fin was an earlier adaptation in the evolution of this group than the loss of armor. Another thing land animals don't have to deal with? Controlling their buoyancy. Metriorhynchids had lighter skeletons that allowed them to easily float at the surface of the water, and this was important for a couple of key reasons. First, breathing, generally considered to be important. Since these animals evolved from ones that lived on land, they had lungs, not gills, so they needed to breathe air. Having a lighter skeleton helped them come to the surface more easily to breathe. And second, thermoregulation. All reptiles are ectothermic, so they need heat from an outside source to stay warm. The whole Mesozoic era was generally a time of warmer water and less extreme seasonal changes in temperature, which made the oceans more hospitable for reptiles. But basking time at the surface of the water would still have been important in cooler weather. Some experts also think that these marine reptiles may have had higher metabolisms than reptiles do today, which would have helped them stay warm. But these creatures had other problems to deal with besides chilly water, like salt. Reptiles today that live in saltwater, like crocodiles and sea turtles, have salt glands in their eyes, nose, or mouth that remove excess salt from their blood and prevent an overload of sodium. Metriorhynchids and other extinct marine reptiles had especially large nasal salt glands, which we know because paleontologists have been able to study these structures in a few incredibly rare internal casts of their snouts. These glands allowed them to efficiently get rid of all the extra salt from taking in so much seawater and eating their salty prey. And catching that prey in the ocean rather than on land meant even more specialized anatomy. Now, many land predators rely on their sense of hearing, but listening for prey in the water is an entirely different process. When we hear a sound, we're able to tell where that sound is coming from based on the difference in time that it takes for the sound to reach one ear versus the other. Ever have a moment when you can't tell where a sound is coming from? It's confusing, right? But sound travels much faster through water than air because water's more dense. And our heads contain a lot of tissues that are also full of water. This means that sounds reach us faster in water. And we kind of pick them up with our whole head, not just our ears, which makes it really hard for animals like us to tell what direction a sound is coming from underwater. So this is where yet another adaptation came in for marine reptiles like the metriorhynchids. In 2020, a team of researchers studied the shapes of the inner ears of several groups of crocs and their close relatives, and found that these shapes were distinct depending on what kind of environment the animals lived in. For example, crocs that were fully terrestrial generally had long, narrow inner ear canals, while marine crocs had short, broad ones. And semi-aquatic crocs, like those alive today, tended to be somewhere in between. The compact inner ear found in metriorhynchids is actually very similar in some ways to what we see in modern-day whales. It's thought that shorter ear canals may have helped them better deal with stimuli caused by things like variations in pressure and the movements of their heads while swimming and diving, though there's still some debate about this. But by sorting out all of these distractions, the metriorhynchids may have been able to hear more clearly underwater and zero in on their targets. Okay, now that the metriorhynchids have solved all the problems of swimming, breathing, and eating, what if they wanted to have kids? Like, you know, little metriorhynchids. I couldn't resist, I'm sorry. Well, these guys had short limbs and small hips, so they wouldn't have had much muscle in these areas, and likely couldn't walk on land at all. So coming ashore to mate and have babies was out of the question. Instead, they probably gave birth to live young while out at sea, just like some ichthyosaurs and mosasaurs probably did. But very few marine reptiles do this today. Now, as you can tell by now, becoming secondarily aquatic required a lot of changes to many different parts of the body. So why did so many reptiles do it? One simple answer? Dinosaurs. I mean, when in doubt, the answer for me is always dinosaurs, no matter what the question is. Dinosaurs were everywhere on land, taking up a lot of the food resources, so heading into the water meant more open niches for reptiles to fill. And not getting eaten by a hungry dinosaur was a plus two. And this worked for them for over 50 million years. But even though the metriorhynchids and other large marine reptiles like mosasaurs aren't around anymore, there are still marine reptiles alive today. There are just fewer of them and they're less diverse than they used to be. Out of about 12,000 reptile species, only around 100 are considered marine, including marine iguanas, sea turtles, saltwater crocodiles, and sea snakes. But many of these species are only found in shallow waters and still spend some time on land, unlike the truly marine reptiles of the past. So what happened to these sea monsters of the Mesozoic? Well, the last of the metriorhynchids lived in the early Cretaceous. And we still don't know exactly why they disappeared. But it may have had something to do with a drop in oxygen levels in the oceans that was triggered by volcanic eruptions about 120 million years ago. This would make some sense, since we know that one of the final nails in the coffin for the other groups of Mesozoic marine reptiles, the ones that made it all the way through the Cretaceous, was rapidly changing ocean chemistry after the KPG impact event. This opened up a niche that marine mammals like whales and dolphins were happy to fill, because yes, they're secondarily aquatic too. They became the new big marine predators, developing similar adaptations as the marine reptiles of the past, with the added bonus of being able to generate their own body heat. So, from the Jurassic period to today, the problems that come with being secondarily aquatic seem to have had the same kinds of solutions. And what we've learned is that it's no easy task to get your sea legs, but once you do, it's smooth sailing until you go extinct. So do you want even more science content? Then you'll want to check out PBS's new show, Animal IQ. Hosted by Trace Dominguez, Animal IQ features deep dives into animal minds to find out just how smart the animal kingdom really is. Like, we know that humans are clever, but can you find your friends in a crowd as well as a baby penguin? Drive a car as well as this rat? Sense Earth's magnetic field like a fox? Head on over to PBS Terra to find out, and be sure to tell them that Blake sent you. And thanks to this month's eontologists who really croc our world. Sean Dennis, Jake Hart, Annie and Eric Higgins, John Davison Ng, and Patrick Seifert. By becoming an Eonite at patreon.com/eons, you can get fun perks like submitting a joke for us to read, like this one from Charles Copley. What do you call a dinosaur that only eats the tastiest food? A connoisseur. Actually, okay, I give you points for that. That's good. And as always, thank you for joining me in the Constantine Haase studio. Subscribe at youtube.com/eons for more evolutionary escapades.